As a family, we've been watching a reality TV show. There's very little to watch these days, isn't there? But we found this great show, and it's all about these competitors who have to tackle an obstacle course. And the competitors have to be strong, they have to be fit, they have to be agile in order to complete it. It's the best of the best in terms of fitness and strength, rock climbers, all kinds of parkour athletes and these type of guys who, and ladies in fact, who compete in this event. And basically the one who gets the furthest and earns the most points in the process is the winner. And there was a competitor that we all liked, and he was doing quite well, seemed like a really nice family man, and we thought, oh, this is a great guy. I wonder if he wins. So my wife and I did what you're not supposed to do. We went to the finale, the season finale, and we watched to see if this guy had won. And sadly, he hadn't won. He'd done really well. He got really far, but another deserving chap won, and this guy was a British war veteran and was really a great story. He did it in honor of his brother. Wonderful story. So we knew who the winner was. Now, we did that because we didn't think we were going to carry on watching, but we kind of got hooked in the series. So we ended up watching back at series at season one again, knowing who was going to win. So we went back watching with our kids back to season one, but now watching from the beginning. And it was very strange knowing all the time who was going to win because we'd watched the season finale of that series. And we knew who was going to win. And so whenever this winning contestant, because we kind of, now you're tracking this guy, you know this guy's going to win. Whenever he was faltering or struggling or close to elimination or losing his grip and falling into the water, the kids were on the edge of their seats. And I just sat there calmly and watched because I knew he was going to win. It's like, oh, he's going to make it through this level because he wins. Obviously, he's going to make it through. And then I realized this. Prophecy is a little bit like that. There are confirmed words in my heart that have been confirmed by other people as God's spoken to me and confirmed it with other people, confirmed words over my life and over this church that I hold on to sometimes when the storms come. And it's great knowing how it will end when you're holding on for dear life and your fingers are slipping in the obstacle course of ministry, in the obstacle course of life sometimes. It's great to have those encouragements. And before I talk any more about personal prophecy, the Bible is an extremely prophetic book. It's a prophetic book. Every prophetic word about Jesus in the Old Testament was fulfilled. Do you know that there were over 300 prophecies predicting the arrival and the life of Jesus, and they were predicted in the Old Testament, they were read by the Jewish nation over many, many years, and Jesus came, and in the New Testament, every single one of those 300 prophecies were fulfilled. It's a prophetic book. Now, here's the good news. There are many prophecies written about your future in the Bible if you're a child of God, and you just have to open your Bible to get a prophetic word about your future. And so, I'm just going to give you a spoiler alert quickly. If you don't want to know how it ends, then don't listen now. Just close your ears. But this is a spoiler alert. Let me tell you how it ends. Jesus wins, God's people win, and the devil loses. Revelations 20:10 says the devil will be thrown into a fiery, burning lake of sulfur. Revelations 21:3 says you are going to live in paradise with Jesus forever in a new heaven and a new earth. The heavenly city is going to come down onto this new earth, and we're going to live in glory with Jesus forever. That's how your end looks like. That's your season finale. And so just like we are able to watch calmly, we were able to watch calmly when the winning competitor was losing his grip, I want to encourage you to hang in there, find peace in the storm, because you know what your season finale looks like. You know how it's going to end. I want to encourage you with that. Encouraged by those words of your future, the Bible predicts how it's going to end, and it's a good ending if we will serve Jesus and make him Lord and Savior. As I shared in part one, though, there are daily battles we have to live with and fight against the devil in. We've got to fight those battles. And we are empowered to win those daily battles, but the Bible prophesies that the big war is won. And so we can take hope in that. But God also speaks to us through his word, through personal prophecy, through speaking specific things into our lives. And he's speaking to us all the time. Very often when God speaks to you and helps to direct your course of action, that's actually a prophetic word he's giving you. He's leading and he's guiding. I really believe sometimes we kind of mystify the prophetic. It's very often some very simple word that God will speak to you in your own life. And he speaks to us and he uses us to speak to other people too through the gift of prophecy. And prophecy is alive and well today. Before we go any further, let me just clarify, we don't prophesy with the accuracy and the authority of the Old Testament prophets anymore, because they were God's actual mouthpiece. So the reason Isaiah's words were written down, his prophetic words were written down in the Bible, because he was speaking the actual word of God, and he was God's actual mouthpiece. Now, the prophecy hasn't died. We don't prophesy in the New Testament now with that same level of authority, but we still prophesy what I believe God speaks into our hearts, and we become, in a way, God's mouthpiece to someone. It's not the Bible, it's not his word for word, but there's an essence, there's a sense that he brings that is what he wants to share with someone, and we can share those things with other people through the gift of prophecy. 1 Corinthians 13 verse 9 says, "Now our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture." That's just a better way of explaining that well-known phrase, as we prophesy in part. So our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. But New Testament prophecy, I believe, reveals as much of the picture as God needs it to for our lives, and it's powerful. It's powerful. And prophecy, the Bible says, is a gift we are to desire. The New Testament prophecy is really, if you study it, it's very clear in the word, it's for edification, it's for exhortation and comfort. Edification, exhortation, and comfort. How many of you don't need some of that in your life? And how many of you don't know that you can really bless someone by giving them some of that as you operate in biblical New Testament prophecy? We are told in 1 Corinthians 14:1 to pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. I've underlined especially that you may prophesy. I really believe God would not tell us to desire something, because this is being written. It's Paul writing, but it's the words of God written on this pen as it was inspired by the Holy Spirit. God's telling us to desire something and earnestly desire, especially that you may prophesy. I really believe God wouldn't tell us to desire something if it wasn't possible to grow in it. Are you with me? So God is not a sadist. He's not going to tell his people, I want you to earnestly desire to prophesy, if he had no intention of allowing you to grow in it. Now, here's the thing. The measure with which you will operate in the prophetic will differ. All right? There are people who operate, as we know, biblically in the office of the prophet, and that's an office, and their words and the measure with which they are given that prophetic gift is much greater than some of us. But it doesn't mean that we can't all grow in some way in the prophetic. And I'll show you now that really was a word God wanted, and it'll be clarified in just a moment. But the prophetic is for all of us, and we need to desire, we need to pursue it earnestly and trust for that gift, especially the gift of prophecy that will grow in our lives. Here's the thing, watching this reality TV series, for me, knowing how it would end, just going through that process, it kind of sucked, because I in the end, I thought, I actually don't want to know how it ends in the TV show. But for me, just sitting through that series, knowing how it would end, it reminded me of the incredible power. It reminded me of the incredible blessing and comfort of the prophetic. And today, I really want to stir you up to earnestly desire it, because it's a gift that will bless you, but more importantly, it'll be a gift that you can use to bless other people. So, Father, I pray that as we unpack your word today, Lord, I pray that you would bless the word, you would cause it to bear much fruit, Father, and you would speak through me, Lord. I don't want to do this in my own strength. Holy Spirit, would you empower me to deliver this word, and would you deliver it into our hearts, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So the message title is Supernatural Favor. I want to welcome all the sites who are joining us too, and we're going to trust God to do something special in our lives today. I believe, and I'm talking about today, I'm talking about supernatural favor. And we're in the series called Supernatural, and I'm talking today about supernatural favor. I believe that one of the major elements of God's favor to us as believers is that he speaks to us, and he enables us to prophesy and operate in the supernatural. You see, I've thought about it. God promises to take care of our needs, but most believers I know aren't fabulously wealthy, right? So I don't think fabulous wealth is the yardstick by which we can measure God's favor. Are you with me? All right, otherwise every Christian would be a multi-billionaire. That's not, God promises to provide for our needs, but that's not the yardstick for favor. I really believe one of the big elements of favor is that God speaks to us and enables us to work in the supernatural. That is a real component of this favor. 1 Peter 2 verse 9, speaking of the favor we have. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood. Talks about us being priests. It talks about favor, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That the living God would call us his own possession surely means we are favored. And this language of this whole text speaks of favor. 2 Peter 1 verse 3 and 4. And you must remember that Peter wrote this. It's the same Peter that preached at Pentecost. And look what, and I'm going to tie that together in a moment. But listen what Peter says in 2 Peter 1, 3 to 4. It says, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. Now, the very great promises that allow us to become partakers of the divine nature, the supernatural nature, certainly include the promises that Peter identified when he preached his sermon after Pentecost. I'll tell you what, I'll read that sermon now in just a moment, an extract from that. Now, we know that a lot of that is talking about this divine nature that we become more and more like Jesus. It's talking about that. But as I studied it, and even the ESV says very clearly, the study Bible says that, and it's a very important link, that Peter is also talking about the fact that we are given the promise of the Holy Spirit, and through him and that promise that's given in that word that Peter preached, as he declared the prophet Joel's prophecy to be true and fulfilled on that day, that is part of this, these promises that we are given. So what are some of these great promises through which we become partakers of the divine nature? What are these promises? Let me read Peter's sermon, Acts 2 from verse 17. And in the last days it shall be, declares the Lord, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I love the way, and this is the prophet Joel that had prophesied this for years, and Peter declares in the sermon he gave at Pentecost out of the upper room, he declares that those words were fulfilled on that day. And from Pentecost onwards, every believer can become a partaker of the divine nature and can prophesy. And I believe, again, that one of the major elements of God's favor is that we as believers can have God speaking to us and he can speak through us. And the fact that we get to be partakers of the divine nature surely indicates God's favor to us as believers. The gift of prophecy surely indicates that. Because here's the thing, you only let your secrets out to your most favored, your favorite friends will hear your secrets and what's on your heart. And God shares those secrets with us because we're favored. And he shares those things with us. And the Bible says in this prophetic word, it's not restricted by age, it's not restricted by social standing. The word was this, even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. You need to understand, and this is a teaching, this section, this little scripture, I go a little bit more on it at the KLS teaching, but you need to understand, to a Jewish person, this was a radical statement, because for hundreds of years they understood that only prophets prophesy. Normal people don't get to operate in the supernatural. And here it says, I will pour out my spirit even on male servants and female servants. You must understand, in those days, women didn't have any rights. Women's rights didn't exist. And servants didn't have any rights. So a female servant was the bottom of the rung. And the Bible says, even on your female servants, I will pour out my spirit. Now, all of that's changed in our modern society. We know that. But what is the essence of what he's saying? He's saying that everyone is included, irrespective of age, irrespective of social standing. God's Spirit is poured out on all believers, and we're favored. Every believer from Pentecost onward is bestowed with this favor. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 4 says, there are different kinds of gifts, but they are all given to believers by the same Spirit. God calls the spiritual powers we are given, these gifts, he calls them gifts. He calls them gifts, and you favor and shower someone who is favored with gifts, and he's favored us by showering us with gifts. And these are gifts that can cause breakthrough in our lives, and more importantly, bring a breakthrough in other people's lives. And 1 Corinthians 12 makes it very clear that these gifts are given to serve other people, not to make us famous, but to serve other people. So this message is all about the supernatural favor of God, and that we are blessed with these gifts. We are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed with the prophetic to be a blessing. This principle of being blessed and favored to bring blessing and favor is a principle that's demonstrated very well in the life of Joseph. And as I will unpack in just a moment, Joseph is one of your ancestors. Did you know that? I'm going to show you now. And so when you study his life, it's something of your past that can help you unlock the present. And the favor he had, the favor that Joseph had, can be traced back to his great-grandfather, Abraham. Joseph's great-grandfather was Abraham. And God blessed Abraham and gave him this promise. Genesis 12, verse 2 to 3. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. And I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. That was God's promise to Abraham. Abraham had a son called Isaac, and Isaac had a son called Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons, and one of them was Joseph. And so the blessing and the promise was passed down to Joseph, because that was the promise that was given to Abraham. And it passed down and passed down all the way to you if you belong to Jesus. Let me show you why. You don't need to do any spiritual gymnastics or theological gymnastics to prove this point. It is black and white. Listen to what Galatians 3:29 says. And now that you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. You are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you. What promise belongs to you? I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. That's your promise. But let's go right back and read about these one of these ancestors in this family line that God says you now belong to. And let's look at Joseph, because Joseph's story speaks to your story. We see the blessing and favor and power of God on Abraham's offspring. We see it begin to emerge through the life of Joseph. And there are many stories that you can take from the life of Joseph. I'm just taking one aspect. It's not the whole story of Joseph. I'm taking an aspect of the story that God showed me that I believe will just speak something into our lives today and how this blessing applies to us. So Joseph had a spiritual gift, as you'll see in a moment, but he didn't understand in the beginning that that spiritual gift was given to him to be a blessing. He just wanted the gift to make him famous. And God actually was going to work something in his life to show him that this gift was given to make God famous and to bless other people. So Joseph was one of 12 sons. I will unpack a little bit of the story of Joseph, because I can't assume in a service like this that everyone knows the story of Joseph. We have new people coming to Jesus who haven't even had time yet to read through the whole Bible. They don't know the story. So bear with me if you know the story well. It's important that we unpack the story and some of the details. Joseph was one of Jacob's 12 sons. And remember, it's important to note that Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and Jacob, or Israel's 12 sons, became the 12 tribes of Israel. So Joseph was one of the sons. Joseph was also Jacob's most favorite son. He was born to Jacob from Jacob's favorite wife, which was Rachel. What a favorites going on there anyway. But this is Jacob. And out of a heart full of love, Jacob bestows this beautiful robe on his favorite son, Joseph. And he adorns him with this robe of many colors, a technicolored robe. And so there's Joseph, age 17, with his brothers around, who are now extremely jealous because they know that he is the favorite, and he's now got this robe. Not only was Joseph favored by a robe that he'd been given by his father, his earthly father, his heavenly father, God, had blessed him with the ability to dream and interpret prophetic dreams. And so Joseph doesn't realize this at the time, but that God had given him this gift so that he could be a blessing to his family. But in the beginning, the gift wasn't such a great blessing to his family, as you'll see in a moment. Now, here's the thing. Joseph's gift would benefit him one day, and the favor of God would benefit him in some way, but it wasn't placed on him. The gifting wasn't placed on him just for him. It was to be a blessing. And that's important, that we are blessed to be a blessing. That's what the promise of Abraham said. And so Joseph has these dreams about sheaves and stars bowing down to him. They're prophetic dreams. And he interprets these dreams as a future time. It's an accurate interpretation of the prophecy. At a future time that his brothers and father and mother would bow down to him. Now, there are some prophetic words God gives you must keep to yourself. Others you must share. Joseph hadn't figured out yet the difference between the two. So he thinks they're prophetic dreams. His brothers think they're pathetic dreams. And It all goes downhill from there. See, Joseph is jumping all over the famous part of the Abrahamic blessing. I will make you famous. He's jumping all over the famous part, not so much on the to be a blessing part. That still had to come. You see, the gift Joseph had, the prophetic gift, would elevate him in time, but not just yet. He had to go down first before God would elevate him. God, now we don't know, it's a theological debate. Did God cause this? I have my own views on this, that it just happened. Either way, God uses what's about to happen to Joseph to do a work in his heart. And so God has to work on his character first. Joseph tells his brothers he thinks it's a good idea. It turns out it's not a good idea to tell them. The brothers are extremely jealous and angry. They want to kill him. Instead, they throw him in a pit and they sell him to slave traders, and they tell their dad, Jacob, that Joseph was killed by a wild animal. They dip his multicolored robe in goat's blood, and they say to his dad, look, Joseph's dead. And so Jacob is devastated, and Joseph is now on his way, well on his way to Egypt. And he ends up in Egypt as a slave working for Potiphar. Potiphar, who was the captain of the guard for Pharaoh. He does very well there until Potiphar's wife makes an advance on him. He was obviously a strapping young Hebrew lad. Maybe Mr. Potiphar didn't look so good anymore, and so he's around looking after the house. And she makes a move on Joseph, and Joseph runs away like a good Hebrew boy. He runs away from her advances. And by the way, men, when temptation comes, you run. Just get up and run. If ever I see someone running down the road randomly, I know you're running from temptation. All right. Take a page out of Joseph's book. The problem is that Potiphar's wife was, you know, they say, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. Potiphar's wife was very unhappy. She accuses Joseph of trying to rape her, which is not what happened at all. She accuses Joseph of trying to rape her, and then Joseph ends up in prison. And I want to just read quickly from Psalm 105. It's a verse I used in the sending. Those of you with the sending, I quoted this verse. It's in Psalms 105:19. It says, until the time came to fulfill his dreams, the Lord tested Joseph's character. God was going to fulfill those dreams of one day his mother and father and brothers bowing down to him, but that wasn't the day. God was working on his character. God had to bring Joseph to a place where he realized that his gifting wasn't actually about him or making him famous or making people bow down to him. His gifting was there to bless other people and make God famous. That's why his gifting was there. You see, when people say, I need a place to use the gifting God has given me, I need a place to express the gifting God has given me, that's the wrong statement. What God wants to hear from us is, I need a place to serve people and glorify God with my gifting. Now, of course you benefit. Of course you are fulfilled when you operate in what God has gifted you with. But that's a byproduct. It's not the end in itself. The most important thing is that we are serving. So Joseph begins to serve with his gifting right there in the prison. Genesis 29, 22 to 23, before long, the warden put Joseph in charge of all the other prisoners and over everything that happened in the prison. The warden had no more worries because Joseph took care of everything. The Lord was with him and caused everything he did to succeed. So there's Joseph serving in the prison. Sometime later, two officials of Pharaoh, the cupbearer and the baker. The cupbearer was the one who took the wine, tested the wine, and took it to Pharaoh. Pharaoh's cupbearer and the baker, Pharaoh's personal baker. Imagine having stuff like that. Anyway, these guys end up in prison, and they end up next to Joseph, and they both have disturbing dreams, and Joseph begins to serve with his gifting right there in the prison where no one can see him. And it's in those moments somewhere when no one can see you that God really begins to test your heart. Will you use the gift I've given you even when you're not going to get any glory from it and you're down in the dungeon and it's dark and no one can see you? And that's where Joseph begins to serve. And Joseph interprets the dreams and gets it spot on. And it's good news for the cupbearer who is reinstated. It's bad news for the baker who is killed. But the cupbearer reinstated goes back to working in Pharaoh's courts and forgets about Joseph, and Joseph stays in prison. He asks Joseph, Joseph says to the cupbearer, will you remember me when you were with Pharaoh? And he doesn't remember, and 2 years later, Joseph's still in prison. And then 2 years pass, and one day, Pharaoh wakes up, and he has a very disturbing dream. None of Pharaoh's magicians and sages can interpret the dream, and they're in trouble. Pharaoh is very angry because he wants answers to this disturbing dream, and no one can give them to him. Now remember, the cupbearer knew about Joseph's prophetic gifting and his interpretation gifting. And so the cupbearer remembers, and I think what happened, I'm filling in some blanks, I think what happened is, so how did the cupbearer get to speak to Pharaoh about this? I think Pharaoh was very disturbed, and he asked for a drink like really early in the morning before breakfast. Like, I need a stiff one now, because this is like really... So anyway, somehow the cupbearer ends up with Pharaoh. Okay, that's not in the Bible. What is in the Bible is that the cupbearer says Joseph was one who could interpret dreams. So they call Joseph right away. They dress him up, bring him through. And suddenly, after serving with his gifting in the prison, Joseph now gets a chance to serve in the palace. And he's summoned. Joseph arrives, and Pharaoh tells him the dream. Seven fat cows are eaten up by seven skinny cows. And seven full-bodied ears of grain are eaten up by seven thin ears of grain. And Joseph immediately interprets the dream. He says, there are 7 years of plenty on the way, but hot on the heels of those 7 years of plenty will be 7 years of devastating famine. And Joseph says, What the prophetic word is showing us is that we need to put a wise and experienced man in charge of the whole country and oversee the stockpiling of grain in the 7 years of plenty, so that when the famine comes, we'll have reserves, because there'll be an abundance in the years of plenty. We can put it all away and have time and have plenty of grain, let me say, to feed everyone in the famine. And so Genesis 41 from the Message says, this seemed like a good idea to Pharaoh and his officials. Then Pharaoh said to his officials, isn't this the man we need? Are we going to find anyone else who has God's spirit in him like this? Can you imagine? It's a pagan king. And he's talking about God with a capital G. God is being glorified right there, because Pharaoh says, isn't this the man we need? Are we going to find anyone else who has capital G, God's spirit, in him like this? So Pharaoh said to Joseph, you're the man for us. God has given you the inside story. No one is as qualified as you in experience and wisdom. From now on, you're in charge of my affairs. All my people will report to you. Only as king will I be over you. God, Joseph's supernatural gift makes a way for him. He has an unfair advantage over all the wisest men in Egypt. And in the moment he comes from the prison into the palace, becomes prime minister of Egypt. He receives, the Bible says, Pharaoh's signet ring. He receives the best robes. He gets a gold chain. And he gets the 2RC chariot. Obviously, Pharaoh had a chariot and the 2RC had a chariot. And that's the chariot that Joseph gets. Basically, in modern speak, he got the corporate jet, it's fueled up, it's on the runway, and there's a pilot waiting to take off at his every command. That's Joseph. That's how his life changes. God's favor and anointing was on Joseph. It made him very successful. We see God's hand on Joseph in Potiphar's house, in prison, and in the palace. And Joseph was propelled into this place of prime minister, not so that he could become rich and famous. It was a byproduct for him, but that was not the purpose. God's favor and anointing was upon Joseph and upon his life, because God was going to use him to save Egypt, Israel, and the surrounding nations from famine. One prophetic word. You see the power of the prophetic. That dream caused him to store up grain and save nations. Because the famine did come, like Joseph prophesied. But it only came once the 7 years of plenty had come, and the word says that Joseph had overseen the stockpiling of so much grain that he'd stopped keeping record of it. There was so much. In other words, the bank accounts of Egypt were so full they couldn't even count anymore how much they had. And that all happened under Joseph's watch. In Genesis 41:57, when the famine came, it says, and people from all around came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph, because the famine was severe throughout the world. Now here's the incredible thing. Later, Joseph's brothers who had sold him into slavery came to buy grain too. And when they came to Joseph, they didn't recognize him and they bowed down to him. And the prophetic word was fulfilled. But Joseph had been placed there to look after them. Because here's what's the incredible thing is. Remember, Joseph was the father of Jacob. Joseph's father was Jacob, let me say. And Jacob's name, I said, was changed to Israel. So Israel's sons, Joseph's brothers, became the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. So when Joseph saved his brothers from the famine, he saved the nation of Israel from famine. Joseph was elevated through God's anointing on his life in order to bring bread to Egypt and bring bread to his own people. And the prophetic gift on Joseph literally saved the nation of Israel from starvation. God released it. It was God's word, but it was released through him. Joseph became a blessing to his family. He became a blessing to Egypt, who had food, and the surrounding nations, the word said, had food. Exactly like the promise that he had received through his great-grandfather Abraham. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. Can you see how that prophetic word is already coming true in Joseph's life? Abraham was his grandfather, and already the word that God had given to Abraham we begin to see fulfilled in Joseph's life. He becomes famous, and he becomes blessed to be a blessing, and he saves the nation of Israel from starvation, and he even is a blessing to the known world. So how does this apply to us? Jesus said, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He was quoting the Old Testament. Jesus was saying, you don't only need physical bread to survive, but you need spiritual sustenance which comes from God speaking to us. That's what he was saying. Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Now, it's talking, I think, primarily about the Bible and about God's Logos word, but it's talking about God speaking to us, and God also speaks to us in our hearts. He prompts us, he speaks to us, he leads us, and he speaks to us through the personal words that we receive from other people. He uses us to speak. That's what prophecy is about. We know those words don't become scripture, but they are powerful, specific words that God releases as an unction through us to someone else, and they bring life to someone. They bring sustenance to someone. They lift someone's spirits. They bring edification. They bring comfort. They exhort people. That's what these words do. God wants us to earnestly desire the gift of prophecy because he wants to use you to feed his people. When we speak prophetic words, we are edifying, we are exhorting, and we are comforting God's people. We're feeding them. We're bringing that sustenance. The Bible says we need, Jesus says we need not just physical bread, but spiritual bread. Joseph's prophetic word was what led to the initiative to store the grain. And it was in those years of plenty. And it was a prophetic word that ultimately released the bread because it put forth the game plan as to how they were going to get bread. So the prophetic word released the bread. Here's the thing, as we operate in the prophetic by bringing God's word to other people, we will be releasing the life-giving spiritual bread they need for that moment. And we can be just like Joseph. And we can bring life, we can bring sustenance. Can God give someone a word they need directly from the Bible or speak directly to them? Of course he can, and he does. He does it all the time. All the time. But he also uses you and I to feed and nurture his people through spiritual gifts. He also partners with us. You see, God could have saved Israel and Egypt from the famine without Joseph. He could have just dropped bread from heaven to feed them without needing Joseph. He could have just dropped bread from heaven. He could have fed them that way. And in fact, here's the thing, later on, he did. Hundreds of years later, when they left Egypt and they were in the wilderness, he dropped manna from heaven. Bread, food literally fell from heaven while they were in the desert. So he can do it that way. But in the passages we read today, I want you to see that God chose to send bread by sending Joseph. And he wants to send spiritual bread to people today in some way by sending you. It's not the only way, but there's a powerful way we can help to feed and uplift other people. His favor is not something you need to wait for. This is what I want to get to really as I close out now. His favor is on you because he wants you to be able to bless other people. You don't need to wait for supernatural favor. You are supernatural favor. You are. Because God can speak to you and through you. God has blessed and favored Harvest and blessed and favored your workplace because he sent you here and he sent you there. That's his favor. And we are heirs of the promise. We are blessed and favored to be a blessing. We are Abraham's seed touching the world with the power of God and feeding those around us. For many of you, the decision to show up at Connect Group or show up at a church shouldn't be based on whether you feel you need it or not. Someone there might need you. You could be God's favor or blessing to someone else. The word you speak to someone in the prayer times at Connect Group or wherever you are, or even at church after the service or before or up front, could be just the spiritual bread they need for the moment. Just like the physical bread Joseph brought through his word, the words you speak as God unctions you, they could be the very bread that person needs, and you could be the favored Joseph that brings God's favor to them, brings his blessing to them. You haven't been clothed with a technicolor robe, a physical robe. You have something much better. Your heavenly dad has given you an imputed robe of righteousness. That's what you are wearing. And not only that, he's breathed his Holy Spirit into you and he's enabled you to be a partaker of the divine nature. You are blessed and you are highly favored. And I want to encourage you with that. You are blessed to be a blessing. In Connect Group, I'm going to ask you to do something different this week. We've been doing this in many different settings, because a lot of what I'm going to share, the practical really comes even outside of these walls. But we've been doing this in many different settings as a leadership. We've done this as a leadership team. We've done it in our wider harvest ministries. And Alphonse and Audrey even did this in Kenya with some of our missionaries there recently. This is what we're going to do. I want to encourage you in Connect Group, and I want you to hold your Connect Group leaders accountable. Leave time to do this. I want to encourage you to break up into groups of four and leave enough time in your time together to break up into groups of four, and in your groups of four, spend time praying for each person so that at each point, someone has the other three in the group praying for them and trusting for words. Some of you are already doing that, but I'm trusting for powerful ministry this week and to create a new wave of this ministry that needs to happen, because we can pray for maybe a few people, but there are 1,000 people who meet roughly, who meet in Connect groups this week. We couldn't pray for 1,000 people here and get words for 1,000 people, but if everyone gets involved, 1,000 people can hear from the Lord this week. And a prophetic word. And I want you to get hooked in how it feels to minister to someone else if you've never done that before. I want you to get hooked, and then I want you to do it again and again and again. I really believe God has, I want to end with this word. I have a prophetic picture of what harvest is going to become, and it's a place where the fruit is growing on our lives and the gifts are flowing. But here's the thing. It's not going to be a church where people say, go to that church because the pastors move in the supernatural. They say, go to that church because the whole church moves in the supernatural. And they're going to want to come and see what's going on here at Harvest. I believe it. The words have come. People will come from other nations to see what he's doing here. They're not going to come to see what I'm doing. They're going to come to see what you are doing. Because God wants to use you. God wants us all to play our part. We'll play our part. But I really believe our most exciting days still lie ahead of us. But Harvest, we've got to step very intentionally into what God is calling us to become. We've got to create the space. You've got to be intentional about creating that time to allow the Lord to speak through you. Father, I pray now in Jesus' name, God, that you would seal this word in our hearts as we stand together. Would you seal this word in our hearts? Father, I want to pray, God, that we would become the church that you have called us to become. Father, a church where every single member is stepping up into your calling and operating in the gifting that you have given them. Father, your word says that you give gifts distributed by the Holy Spirit as you choose. Your gifts are spread out and we have them. God, I want to say we are determined to operate in them. If you want to just with me, just stand now and just as a declaration to God, say, God, I'm going to be a whole lot more intentional about creating a space for the supernatural to move. This series, if it does nothing else, I simply want us to become a lot more intentional about operating in the supernatural, about creating the space for God to move. Now I want to encourage you as you wake up. As you wake up in the morning, say, God, what do you want to say to me today? I'm listening. Who do you want me to speak to? Who do you want me to send a message to? Who do you want me to phone? And I'll say this. There are some of you here, you don't have a whole lot of time in the day because of your work situation or because of maybe where you are with parenting. God's going to drop things into your heart when you least expect it. And you're going to write a message to someone that's going to rock their world. And it's going to have taken you like 30 seconds or a minute or two, depending how fast you type. But you're going to rock someone's world. And it's not going to be you. It's going to be the power of God on you, because you are blessed. You are favored to be a blessing. And God, I really believe God says to us as a people, my people, I have a destiny for you as a church. I want to model something, but you've got to step into it. And here's the thing, guys. As a leadership team, we're up front here. We can't do this on our own. This is not just about us. This is about everyone stepping into the calling God has for it. We've got to take some intentional steps. And why wouldn't we want to be used of God? So Father, we're saying, here we are. We want to be available, not just in these four walls, but out of these four walls. I have a prophetic word which I released this morning. We've got 4 minutes left. Just while your eyes are closed, I just want to just minister a few things. I believe a lot of the ministry will happen in the Connect groups and in other spaces, but let's just take this moment now. I want to share this word, but I really believe, and I've shared it this morning, and I believe it's for the sites as well, for some people there. But there are people who are in business, and God is saying this. He says the business textbooks are all great, but it's time to close them now. If you're in business, it's time to close those books and go to the closet and read my word and begin to get my word for your business. Because God says to you, I have strategies and I have plans which you're not going to find in a textbook, where they're going to unlock things that are going to potentially save your business, either the business you own or the business you're working for. And there's favor coming, and you're going to begin to have ideas and strategies that are prophetically imparted to you. And you don't have to say, thus saith the Lord, in the board meeting or wherever you meet, but you can begin to share what God is saying, and people will see it's God, because they'll say, this has to be God. This is divine. And I really believe to say that there are some here, God says, the books are great, the studies are great, but just close the books of Babylon for a moment and come away with me, because I want to speak to you about your business. I want to give you strategies and things you have no idea that will blow your mind, but they're going to be straight from my heart to yours, and they will unlock something in your business. And they're not only going to save the business, but they're going to bring glory to me, says the Lord. And I really believe that's for some of you. If that's for you, just receive that word. Thank you, Jesus.